Ladies and gentlemen, a very good evening to all of you here. On behalf of ESSEC Asia Pacific, we would like to welcome you to our campus and also thank you for taking the time to attend our masterclass on real estate finance. Be ready when the next real estate bubble bursts. Our speaker and expert for tonight is Dr. Patrick Lecomte. Patrick is the Executive Director of the Advanced Master in Financial Techniques, Asia Track, and a research fellow at ESSEC Business School, Asia Pacific. He specializes in real estate finance and financial innovation applied to commercial real estate. Patrick has been invited to be a speaker in numerous industry conferences and has published his research in numerous journals as well, such as the Real Estate Portfolio Management, Real Estate Literature, and the Institutional Real Estate Letter. So tonight, I would like to welcome to the floor Patrick and ask him to share his insights on this topic. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much for being here. Good evening. So my name is Patrick Lecomte. I'm very happy actually to have a group of people tonight to share this presentation about speculation in real estate markets. Because the title was Be Ready When the Next Bubble, Property Bubble Burst. But you know, I'm an academic, so I like to have less definitive title, I would say. So the title actually is a short introduction to speculation and sustainability in real estate markets. You can translate speculation by greed and sustainability by virtuous market. Because really the point I would like to make tonight is that what we are all trying to do in academia, regulators, even to some extent investors, what we are trying to do is to define what could be a virtuous real estate market. And hopefully at the end of this presentation, we'll have a better idea. So first, ESSEC. I was asked to present ESSEC. You are here today on our Singapore campus. ESSEC actually is a very large institution in France. In Europe, we have 147 faculties. We have teaching chairs, including one in real estate, which is sponsored by BNP Paribas. We have research institutes. We have partners all over Asia. So in Singapore, we are partner with the three top universities, NUS, NTU, SMU. In China, Tsinghua, Peking, Fudan, and so forth. ESSEC is very close to lots of companies, so the corporate partners. And we have top-ranked programs. So the program I'm in charge of is this one. We are number two in the world. I guess this is the best-kept secret in Singapore, is that actually the number two best program in finance in the world is actually based in Singapore. It's a French program, yes. And it's managed by ESSEC and by myself, the ranking from the Financial Times 2013. We're also quite active in executive education. We are very good in training people for management. We have this Master of Science in Management, which is a very elite program in France, and we're also very good in executive MBA. So this is about ESSEC. So you are here today in what we call the campus, which is actually a floor in the National Library. We have a partial floor on the ninth floor and other classrooms in a nearby building. But we are also involved in building our own campus in Singapore. It's going to be in One North. So here you have a view of the of what it's going to look like. It's going to be a nice campus designed for over 1,000 students, as far as I know. And this campus in France, I mean, in the suburb Paris and in Paris for executive education. So that's ESSEC. Enough about ESSEC, and let's talk about real estate. So really, I was looking for a title, I was looking for a way to describe what I want to do. And I was like, what can I say? Is it going to be about bubble burst? Is it going to be about speculation and so forth? And I said, no, it's going to be about the truth. For once, I will try to say the truth about real estate. What nobody ever tells you about real estate. I won't use technical lingo. I won't try to sugarcoat everything. No, it's going to be the truth about real estate. So the truth about real estate is actually very complex. And the bottom line, as I said before in the introduction, is how could we define what could be a virtuous real estate market? And virtuous, of course, is open to a question. What is virtue when we're talking about the market? And this is a dimension I will talk about. And I would say a sub-question, but quite important as well, is about greed. Is greed in property markets good or bad? Because we come from, all of us, we come from capitalist countries. So, and it's a business school, so we are trained to believe that greed is good because of the invisible hand. So it's good to be greedy, it's good to want your property to increase in value, it's good to want to make money. But Is it applicable to real estate, actually? Is it applicable to real estate markets? Is greed something which is positive for society in general in those property markets? So hopefully, at the end of this lecture, we'll have some elements to answer those questions. So first, let's start with basically more recent history, but I think it's good to have that in mind. What we have been going through over the last 7 years, basically the subprime crisis. What happened during the subprime crisis? Well, it's an interesting mix, actually, of advanced financial engineering with what J.P. Morgan teams invented in the 1990s, those collaterals, mortgage obligations, and extremely dysfunctional real estate markets. So basically, when you mixed financial markets with extremely sophisticated financial engineering and extremely dysfunctional property markets, you end up with a disaster. And we have been through this disaster, we survived this disaster. Have we learned from this disaster? I mean, the question is open. I don't have the answer, actually. So what really happened during this disaster? Actually, during this disaster, there was a new breed of subprime borrowers who defaulted massively and faster than expected, and they just walked out of their mortgages. So basically, people who owned those mortgages were left with properties, and they were unable to resell those properties. And because of that, the amount of loss was much, much, much larger than was initially anticipated by the models which were used to design those financial instruments. What was the origin for this disaster, actually? Well, I believe that the origin of this disaster was misconception about the property market, because most people who were involved in designing those collateralized mortgage obligations, RMBS, CMBS, actually, did not really know or care about real estate. To give you an idea, in 2006, I was in the States. I just moved to University of Cincinnati, which is quite well known for real estate. You have a lot of researchers there. And I remember waiting on the finance faculty to meet my the guy we work with, the professor we work with. And on the cover of Forbes, the cover was how to make money on the poor, look at those mortgages. And somehow, you know, coming from Europe, this very conservative provincial background, I was like, ooh, it seems strange. It doesn't smell so good. What could happen, actually? I don't know. Something was like, hmm. And then the next year, I went to a conference, a big real estate conference in the States, and I was presenting a paper on property derivatives, which is something I've been doing research on. And I remember the paper right before me was a paper written by economists from Fannie Mae. And they were the first to talk about the impact of delinquencies on house prices in certain neighborhoods. So this was really the first time in 2007 that researchers, academics, started to say something is happening. It came from Fannie Mae. But all the other guys, basically all the other guys, we totally missed it. Like something happened, we didn't see it. And this is really, I would say, a characteristic of property markets, is that most of the time, we don't understand what's happening. We don't know, because it's very, very complicated. And the models we might be using when they come from finance are not applicable to property markets. So what is actually a property bubble? So the definition which has been given by researchers following the subprime crisis is basically a housing bubble is defined by rapid increases in property values to the point of unsustainable levels, followed by a steep decline to the point in which the mortgage debt exceeds the value of the property itself. Okay? So if you think about what was said by this controversial journalist in his editorial in Forbes recently, basically he talked about that. Talked about loan-to-value ratios, so it was all about that, basically. It was, well, so we expect that probably at some point there will be a steep decline to the point in which the mortgage debt will exceed the value of the property itself. MS answered saying no, because loan-to-value ratios in Singapore are very solid, so it will not happen. This is really what it was about. But just as financial crises are not identified until actually the markets are starting to go down, it's basically the same for property markets. But there's one difference between financial markets and property markets, the nature of the asset. If you're talking about a stock bubble, basically, you have the liquidity to get out of the market or to get into the market. If you're talking about properties, you don't have the same ability to get in or out of the market because the underlying asset is not liquid, which means the impact of the bubble might be a lot more dramatic and long-lasting than for stocks. Okay, so now we know what a property bubble is. really, so some research has been done in the US following the crisis. Actually, a lot of researchers suddenly realized they completely missed the boat on what happened. And they started to look at numbers, to crunch some numbers. And on this slide, you have actually the explanation of what happened in the US during before and during the subprime crisis. So basically, between the late 1990s and early 2000, on average, in the States, house prices grew by 6.5% a year, so which is a substantial increase over many years. But what researchers discovered, which is really interesting, and we know it, I mean, we feel it if we follow a little bit what's happening in the States, most of the speculation was focused on the coast, East Coast, West Coast. And one region which was really, really affected by speculation, and interestingly, it's not the first time, was California. California, from the year 2000 to 2005, actually, on average, there was an annual increase of house prices of 15% per year. So this is quite dramatic. And most people initially said, okay, so in California, in Florida, it's all because of speculation. The market was speculative. So as Americans say, pigs will get slaughtered. Okay, they got slaughtered. So be it. Actually, no, if we look at the research, if we look at the numbers, speculators have, I mean, nothing to really do about but the crisis. I mean, overall, we are really talking about fundamental economic variables impacting speculation on those markets. And one factor which was really, really instrumental in explaining the basically the burst in those markets was the fact that in some of those markets, the supply was inelastic, meaning the ability to build new properties was extremely limited. And especially, actually, there was some research which was done in California looking at the topography of the coast and all that, and whether you can build or not build. And in the areas where actually the construction was limited, the burst, the impact of the burst was much, much, much deeper than in other areas. So basically, it means in economic terms that the more elastic the supply in a market, the less prone to a bubble the area where the supply is located, actually, it will be. But of course, it's too easy to only blame supply. User of space, people who actually were buying the space were also responsible, and especially in the States, because there was a huge impact because of the increase of home ownership. In 1999, 66.8% of the Americans owned their own houses, and it rose to 69% in 2006. Each percentage point represents 1 million units. So we are talking about huge numbers of properties. So really, the increased demand was due to this shift from renting to homeownership for single family households. And it's interesting because we see exactly the reverse today. In the States, you see a lot of people being interested in renting instead of owning their own dwelling. Of course, there was also speculation on the part of homeowners. They all bet on the continued appreciation of their houses. Last but not least, and this is where I guess some regulators, at least the central bank, should feel a little concerned as well, the issue of low nominal interest rate was instrumental in fueling this increased demand and ultimately resulting in the burst of the bubble. But last but not least, actually coming from Europe is something we are very sensitive to. This issue of virtual removal of wealth and income as barrier to homeownership. Because in the States, basically, there was no incentive from the mortgage brokers to look at the creditworthiness of the people buying those houses because all that was recycled because of this innovation invented by J.P. Morgan in the 1990s. So it's like a perfect system. It's like printing money in a way. But it's printing money in a Macau kind of way. I mean, it's kind of a casino, if you will. So is it sustainable? Mainly if you are the one receiving the money, yes. But the system itself, of course, is not sustainable. So looking at all those different factors, we can ask ourselves, are all those factors gone today? I mean, how many of you in the room are homeowners? How many of you are hopeful that the value of their homes will increase to the point when they decide to sell it? Reasonably optimistic? Unreasonably optimistic? So, I mean, In fact, whenever we own an asset, we are all somehow speculators, because we all hope that there will be an appreciation. It's a classic bias, actually, that we all have. I mean, ask any valuers. The person owning the asset will always tell you it's worth more than actually they're willing to put a value on. It's a normal bias that we all have. So the speculative mind is still here, actually. Low nominal interest rate. Do we still have low nominal interest rates here today in the world?
Yes.
So basically what I'm trying to say here is that some of the tenants of that led to this burst, to this bubble burst, actually, are still in place. And we will see actually that it has become a global phenomenon again. So in terms of understanding the way markets work, we all know that. I mean, I'm sure we have all been through this cycle before. I mean, anybody who has ever invested in any kind of asset has gone through this cycle. I mean, I was working as an investment manager in the 1990s, early 2000. I went through this cycle for my clients when they were obsessed with the internet stocks. So, you know, you go on this ride from optimism, you get very euphoric, wow, it's a great investment, it's a great market, and then suddenly it's going down. So it depends on your risk profile. Are you risk averse? Are you prone to take risk? But you know, you might feel a little giddy about it. But still, okay, it's temporary. Let me average down my price, because I still believe in the investment. And then all the way down, and then, okay, no, I can't take it anymore. It's way too risky. I sell. I don't want to think about it anymore. Many people did that, actually, with internet stocks. And then, well, people are so desperate. People are so sad, suddenly up, hope again, you know, because we are all human beings, so there's always light at the end of the tunnel. So we go through this cycle. The problem is that it works for financial assets. It's called behavioral finance. We understand it quite well, something which has been researched. But does it work so well for property markets? Is it so simple for property markets? Do we go from all those, from optimism to euphoria all the way to capitulation, dependency, and then optimism again when we are talking about our home, basically, or property investment? And the answer is no, actually. It's a lot more complex than that, because real estate markets are different from financial markets. Most people who decide to invest in property markets, I would say, I mean, the professional investors, usually they come from a financial background. So they tend to think in terms of risk-return profiles, they apply the usual models like CAPM and so forth. The fact is that we are talking about idiosyncratic assets. We are talking about heterogeneous assets. Each house is different. Even in something as standardized as a condo in Singapore, it depends on how much sun you get. It depends on how close you are to the elevator. So you have all those hedonic variables that will impact the price of your property. So ultimately, it's very difficult to think in terms of standardized assets. It's almost impossible. Actually, I was told recently there was this two buildings on Wall Street, and one was deemed very interesting, very good investment. Another one very similar, which was just like, not even a block away. Actually, it was not interesting at all. Although they look exactly the same and they seem exactly alike, to somebody who's not trained. And this is really the issue. We are talking about physical assets. We are not talking about financial assets. So a building or home or apartment is a physical asset. And it belongs to a market which is different from the financial market. It belongs to the space market. So the space market is a market for space. So when anybody arrives in Singapore, maybe the first experience we have is dealing with the space market in Singapore, which means finding a place where we can live. And it's always an interesting experience to get to know a city and its people. So the space market is driven by supply and demand. And this is where factors like the ability to build, so elasticity of the supply. So like in California, when we are talking about a topography which is not so positive for construction, then supply is not elastic. All that will be part of the space market. But a building is also part of a broader market, which is basically the asset market, or if you will, it's a financial asset, which will be used by investors to generate income from rents and price appreciation upon sale. So actually, it's an asset market, and because it's an asset market, it might be prone to speculation, irrespective of the space market, and that's why in some cities, for instance in Paris, you will see buildings which are owned by large institutional investors, and they might be empty, but at the same time, you will be people who don't have enough space to live, or not space at all, actually, they live in the street. So, you know, this discrepancy between the space and the asset market, actually. Those two markets have to work in sync and hopefully harmoniously. But because of this dual nature of what a property is, there are huge risks to the economy. Because, of course, there are always risks to the economy when an asset market will get out of control. But in this case, we are also talking about a market which is linked to the space, so which is physical. And what we have discovered, again, with the subprime crisis, is that there are significant systemic risks which are linked to property markets. And when I say again, actually it's quite, actually, I mean, we should be a little ashamed of ourselves, because actually, ever since we had the Industrial Revolution in Europe, in the UK, in France, in Germany, and so forth, meaning large number of people moving to cities, so massive urbanization, so basically mid-19th century, ever since we have been through this process of Industrial Revolution, we have been dealing with property bubbles. And one of the most dramatic property bubbles in the world actually was in Europe in 1873. And it was a huge crisis. And at the time, Paris was being built. Like, I don't know if you've been to Paris recently, but Paris is a city with lots of old buildings. All those buildings were being built at that time in the 1870s, what we call Haussmannian building. So all those beautiful buildings. But actually, in some neighborhoods, those buildings were completely empty, because the construction was done out of sync with what users, space users, were actually looking for. Meaning they were built by financial speculators, financial investors, but not built with space users in mind. So when you have a crisis happening in a city, meaning prices, a pressure down on prices, and you have high rate of vacancy because people are not using the space, then it's recipe for disaster, because there is no safety net for the properties. And it started in Europe in 1873. It's called the Vienna stock market crash. Okay, so it's a long time. And then it happened again in the 20s. It happened again in the US. There were some issues in the 70s and so forth. And again today. I mean, to the point that some people are a little tired of it. And one guy, his name is Robert Shiller. He's a Yale economist, and he got the Nobel Prize recently. Actually, in the early 2000s, he wrote a book, and he said, guys, we need to find a way to stop that cycle of bubble burst in properties. And one way to do it is to develop advanced financial instruments. And we'll talk about that later, because this is a topic I do research on. But so systemic risk, OK, so again, it happened. But it's not new, actually. It's part of the process of the workings of property markets. Ever since we have been massively urbanized. So what is the true nature of property markets? And this is the first truth about real estate. What is the true nature of real estate markets? And I have goodies for anybody who will answer correctly. ESSEC goodies. So is it a value market, basically a market focused on rental values? Is it a growth market, a market focused on capital appreciation? Or is it a momentum market, a market focused on sentiment? What do you think?
Three.
B. Who said all three? Well, I don't have enough goodies for all of you, so you're going to have to share. So yes, all three. And this is actually the problem, is that the market, the real estate market, is actually a chameleon. It's not one, I mean, it's easy when you're dealing with some stocks, you know there are value stocks, there are growth stocks, the market is a momentum market. And even in finance, we have ways to identify that. I mean, for those of you who have done research in finance, those guys, again, Nobel Prizes, Fama and French, those factors, three factors, five factors, they are used to identify actually what type of stocks we are dealing with. But for property markets, we don't have ways to do it. They're actually chameleons. They change, and their nature will be based on different factors. And actually, some of the factors that will define whether they are value, growth, or momentum are actually defined by the markets themselves. So it's kind of a vicious cycle. It's very difficult to understand exactly what's happening. And That's why property markets are well known for their cyclicality and the fact they are really immersed into the broader economy. And it makes them very difficult to understand, a lot more difficult to understand than stock markets, for instance. And one guy, actually, who is today completely forgotten, in the 1930s, got the Nobel Prize. His name is Simon Kuznets. He was one of those Russian-American economists, Russian moving to America after the Russian Revolution. I think he was at Princeton, one of those top Ivy League US universities. And he defined what has been known as Kuznets swings. And those Kuznets swings are nothing more than relatively short-term waves within the larger quantitative waves. So those quantitative waves are not so popular anymore. People don't really care about them like they used to do when the economy was really, I would say, planned economy in the 70s, for instance. But still, it's really interesting to remember that looking at numbers from 1770 to 1925, so basically all this period of the Industrial Revolution in Europe, what Kuznets found is that there are infrastructural investment cycles or building cycles, and those cycles are between 15 and 25 years. What's interesting, because in the States, people say that usually the property cycle is 18 years. So it seems to fit with those Kuznets swing. In Singapore, actually, I read recently that the property cycle is supposed to be 11 years. This is what people say. I don't know on what it's based. But what Kuznets explained is that actually there is a way to smooth the cycle of bull and burst by taxing the value, taxing land. And this will smooth the cycle of boom and burst. If you think about what's happening in China, it's really interesting. Because what is actually the property cycle in China? What is the length of the property cycle in China? Nobody knows. Because it hasn't been tested yet. We're talking about new markets, so we don't know. And what will be possibly the way for the Chinese to modify the shape of their property cycle? Again, I mean, there are many, many suggestions. And at ESSEC, I did some suggestions in several articles last year. But taxes is definitely a way to smooth the cycle of boom and burst, which means next time when you pay your property tax, don't complain about the government. They're just trying to make it work for us to avoid this cycle of boom and burst. So those questions are really relevant today, especially having China in mind. So this is a very fancy slide. I'm very proud of this slide, even though I didn't do it myself. It comes from this Economic Indicator Services, which is a website, very good website. And actually, it's called the 24-hour real estate clock, because you have two dials. You have the inside, the white dials, and you have the outside, the blue dial. And what does it say? Basically, it describes all the steps that the property markets will go through from, as we saw before, optimism to the next step of extremism, but in between with basically a cycle. And this cycle is quite interesting to look into details, but I won't get into too much details. But actually, there is a first phase, which is about rent. So really, when we're talking about rent, we're talking about fundamentals. Suddenly, people are interested in fundamentals. They're interested in how much yield they will get out of the property, so it's all about rent. So rent, so rent will increase, you know, for 1 to 3, then it increases again, then even buildings which are not so incredible, so top-notch, so older buildings, the rents will increase. So because the rent increase, it becomes more profitable to build up. And this is where it starts to become a little complicated, because it means the space market is being affected, because there will be new supply. Developers are getting on the jump wagon because they can actually make a profit out of their development because the rents are increasing. People are willing to pay more. So then there will be even more growth in new buildings because it's so profitable. Let's build and make money. So because there's this development frenzy, the banks will follow suit and there will be an expansion of funding and financing. So it becomes more and more easy to get credit. Loan to value will rise tremendously. I mean, all the way to the point that suddenly some people who may be a little more conservative will say, wow, what's happening there? Is it too much suddenly? But still, you know, nothing really is catastrophic yet, so it's just a slowdown. And then you change dial, you go on the blue one, and you see there will be a land boom. The land boom, why? Because it's profitable to build, so people are still on the momentum and they are willing to pay more for land. And people will start complaining about property taxes. Because, oh, why do they tax us? I mean, really, party poopers as governments, we don't need to be taxed. I mean, such a good deal. But then, you know, some government will get very lavish about spending for public works. This is interesting. Does it ring a bell about what's happening in the region? Oh, what's happening? Does it ring a bell about what's happening in the region, this lavish government spending for public works? Come on. I'm sure it does.
Huh?
No, not in Singapore. Come on, it's a perfect world in Singapore. Not Singapore. Not Singapore.
China.
Yes, China. Exactly. You see, land boom, lavish government spending for public works. Well, on this slide, you don't have the consequence on that, which is called LGFV. Local government financing vehicles. Okay, but it's definitely part of this clock. Then real estate activity frenetic. So there will be a peak, really, like it's really a lot of momentum. People get a little tired, and then activity will be reduced. There will be a start in foreclosure, but people are still in denial. Really, no, not really. But then you know the economy start to take a dip, and so the stock market will enter possibly in a bear market, and so credit creation institutions will reverse their policies, no more credit. So the economic activity will stop. And then we will need to clean up the mess. So we clean up all the mess. And then stocks start to climb again. And whew, we're all happy, light at the end of the tunnel. And the rent will start to increase again. And here we go again. Wonderful. Where do you think we stand in Singapore? The white one, the blue one, which one? Blue one? Ooh. Tell me why.
Hmm?
15? Are still frenetic the peak?
60.
So it's like people going to those viewings but not necessarily buying? So I guess that would be a good way to describe 16. 17, I don't think so ever in Singapore. Where do we stand in China? I mentioned that, so we are past that. It's no more 14 hours anymore. We are
16 also.
16 also? I would say 17. Because we're starting to see some foreclosure in Chinese real estate markets, actually. Some developers are foreclosing. Having invested in shopping malls in third or fourth tier cities was not such a great idea. So those people are starting to suffer. Actually, it has an impact on some Singaporean developers. One in particular that I won't mention, but it was mentioned recently in the media. They are concerned about actually their investment in shopping malls in China. Stock enter a bear market from past all-time high. Well, you could say actually the REITs are kind of not in such good shape right now. So for the REITs, it's a little complicated. Why are the REITs not such in good shape? Is it because of the rate, anticipation about rate increasing? Is it about the underlying property of portfolios? So this one is still open, but. Yes, I would say in Asia, we're starting to be here. Now, does that mean we will go all the way there? No, because I believe that Asian governments, contrary to most Western governments, have the ability to go back in time. So we will see that. I think we will go back in time. And because we go back in time, everything will be fine. I'm pretty sure of that. OK, so now, what about the situation? Actually, it's quite interesting. I've explained all that. I told you what happened in the 20 during the subprime crisis in the States. We know now that we have done research. No more excuse. Most Fannie Mae researchers actually fired. So you know, we need new people doing research. No excuse to be blind. So we know that. But still, just go on Google and enter housing property bubble. And what will you find? You will find that people are very, very concerned about China. Actually, from over the last year in China, from Q1 2013 to Q1 2014, new home prices have jumped 18.8% in Beijing and almost 28% in Shanghai. So, of course, Beijing and Shanghai are not China. But still, I mean, it's a concern. The issue is also prevalent in Taipei. If you look at the titles of Taiwanese newspapers, they will talk a lot about property bubble. In Hong Kong as well. In Hong Kong, actually, the government of Hong Kong has issued a series of recommendations to nip it in the bud. In Singapore as well. Actually, when I moved to Singapore, I was very happy because coming from France, I realized that actually there is a huge knowledge of real estate issues in the media that you have in newspapers, that you have on TV. And actually, if you watch carefully China News Asia, their business shows, they will talk a lot about property bubble, the property markets, not even residential and commercial. Singapore, definitely. Malaysia, yes. Oh, in Malaysia, they keep talking about the property bubble and the issue that it might represent for the economy. Thailand, even. In spite of the crisis, everything that's happening, people are concerned about the property bubble. Philippines as well, because of all those foreigners going there and buying properties, condos. Wow, prices are increasing. People are really, really concerned. Even in Australia, actually. Recently, the title of a newspaper in Sydney was Sydney Housing Speculation Goes Bananas. And one of the trigger for this article was the fact that foreigners are fighting to buy the parking lot underneath the Sydney Opera House. So it's like a signal that for Australians that actually is getting banana. But in the States as well, which is even more surprising because in the States, I mean, come on, they are the guys who created all this mess in the first place. And now it's coming back again. Actually, on CNBC last month, Bob Shiller, so the guy I mentioned, says that there is a certain substantial amount of momentum in the housing market, much more so than the stock market. I think this boom we saw last year and half in home prices has something to do with quantitative easing and the record low mortgage rates. So again, a momentum market. Momentum means a market driven by sentiment, not by facts. It's the first step, I mean, the door opener to speculation. He didn't say speculative markets, but he said momentum. So in economic lingo, this is what it means. And then, in California again, I mean, people are so concerned in San Francisco that there was a call for what they call the Harvey Milk's anti-speculation proposal. Harvey Milk, it was a movie actually. The guy was a city official. And in 1978, he said, enough of this speculation, enough of prices going up in San Francisco, we have to task. And at the time, he said, there should be a 50% tax on immediate sales of newly purchased property. It was never enacted, but people are talking about it again because there is a lot of speculation of flipping of properties in San Francisco. And recently, even in the Middle East, and of all places in Dubai, I mean, remember what happened with Dubai. Dubai was a total mess. And actually, so in Dubai, the IMF said, well, you know, it's going too far, so the authorities have to intervene to cool the market because the market has recovered so much from the global financial crisis. It's really interesting in Dubai, because I remember I talked to that guy many years ago, who was my mentor, and the guy was head of research for ING Clarion. ING Clarion used to be a large real estate investor. And I said, so, are you investing in Dubai? And he said, Patrick, when you go on top of a skyscraper and all you see is sand, do you really feel that you have to invest, you feel secure? Actually, no, you can't invest when all you see is sand. But sand or land or whatever, why? Because it means unlimited supply. So you don't invest in a market where there's unlimited supply because basically it's going to be speculative. And of course, it will eventually collapse. So in Dubai, of all places, the IMF, Christine Lagarde said, no, you have to intervene. And then even in kind of exotic places, I was shocked myself. In Kenya, actually, people are talking about property prices going up. In Africa nowadays, people are concerned about property speculation. And in Cuba, do you believe that actually in Cuba, they opened up the real estate markets in 2011? So now people own their house in Cuba. So what do they do in Cuba? I mean, you are poor like a Cuban because you were repressed by Fidel Castro for so many years. Suddenly you own an asset. What do you do? The first thing you do? You try to sell it, to cash in. And this is exactly what they do in Cuba. The problem is that in Cuba, but people, they don't have the culture of maintenance. and the property are totally random. I mean, they are completely, I mean, they're not usable. But people don't think about that. So they ask high prices. And until recently, foreigners or Cubans living abroad could buy properties in Cuba. And I'm sure it's a good investment, actually, when I think about it. Because, come on, it's a beautiful island, lots of potential, nice houses, you can justify all that. And in 10, 15 years, it's going to be free anyway, because they won't be able to maintain the regime as it is. It's going to be like a backyard for rich Americans. It's a good investment, I'm sure of that. But the Cubans, they know. So they want actually to get the cash. And now the government in Cuba is getting really concerned about it because there is speculation. And one indicator of speculation is the fact that each month there are 100,000 ads for new properties for sale in Cuba. And the stock in Cuba is considered to be 3 million houses. So each month Cubans want to sell more. So you see, we have this global fears and actually this global picture of again, speculation, bubble actually building up of people being concerned all over the world. But of course, you don't see France, you don't see Europe, because, well, not yet, but soon, probably soon. But in Paris, not yet, actually. The market is still in the doldrums. So, bubble again. So what can we do about that? So, you know, we know that we have been through the process, we have lost money, we have suffered. Many people have lost their jobs, their homes, and all that. We are aware of that. But still, people all over the world are taking part into the building of a bubble. So my question is, and this is the second truth about real estate, do you believe there is an invisible hand at play in real estate markets? Basically, do you believe that the real estate markets can be self-regulating? What do you think? This one is for free, I have no more goodies. What do you believe? It's a tricky one. You see, we come from a capitalist background. Well, we believe in Adam Smith. It's one of the big truths we believe in. And so do you think it applies to real estate markets? Because it applies to all markets, supposedly. Do you think it applies to real estate markets? Do you think that real estate markets can be self-regulating? One hypothesis of Adam Smith is this almost smooth, automatic, swift, fast adaptation of markets by the meeting of supply and demand. So that's why I move my hand like that. But do you believe in that for real estate markets?
Well, so far, I mean, from experience, I mean, whenever there's the bubble burst, always the government has to intervene to do something.
Well, even when financial markets actually burst as well.
Yeah.
The government always has to intervene. So even for financial assets, they intervene. So yes, so...
So
that
cannot be...
So it doesn't... Actually, in the way we think about capitalism, it doesn't mean that because there is a mess, that it should not be self-regulated. So if yes, do you think this impact is good or bad? And last but not least, hence, do you feel that real estate markets should be regulated or left unregulated? And actually, following the subprime crisis, the main school of thought about that was that actually, no, we cannot leave real estate markets to be unregulated because it's way too dangerous. Because we're not talking about automatic adjustments between two invisible, greedy hands trying to get whatever they can. No, we are talking also about physical assets. And we're talking about liquid assets. What does it mean? It means assets which will take a lot of time, a lot of friction to adjust. And also, what do we know about the point where supply and demand will meet? How do you understand that? I mean, it's easy. If you trade a stock, you have bid, ask price, you meet. If you buy an option, you go online, for instance, on whatever exchange website. There is a price, a range of price, you find your price within that range, and that's it. So the meeting of supply and supply prices, demand prices, is very easy for financial assets because they're liquid markets, but not for property markets. Because in many cases, you will see prices moving like that. It's like a staircase. How do we call this step, actually? How do we define this step? It's supposed to be. Well, the length of this step will be defined by landlord's holding power. Okay, so the price you want to sell the property is P at time T. And this is the price you want. No demand. You wait until you cannot wait anymore. You adjust your price down. So it's like you wait, adjust your price down, you wait, adjust your price down. So basically the process of this process of supply and demand and the prices where there can be equilibrium between the two is something which is messy and it takes time. On financial markets, it's going to be automatic, basically. It's something which is done almost instantly. And the spread will be as limited as possible because the market is are efficient. If the market are not efficient, the spread will be large, and most probably, savvy investors will try to take advantage of it. Okay? In property markets, it doesn't work like that. So because of that, the adaptation process, which is supposed to be smooth and swift, that's the invisible hand defined by Adam Smith, should bring to the markets doesn't work. And that's why those markets have to be regulated. If they are not regulated, then the situation becomes very messy. And that's why, again, next time you pay your property taxes, don't complain. So let's have a dream, because you know, I'm an academic. I have this luxury of being in my office all day thinking about new concepts. So let's have a dream. Can we imagine a market where actually imagine a world in which reset markets will be sustainable? Is it possible? Is it something that we can define? Is it something that we can envision? Well, it's tricky, but why not? And what could be a sustainable market? A sustainable market would be a market that will serve the needs of space users while avoiding the pitfalls of boom and bust cycles. And incidentally, but it's very important actually, the spread of systemic risk in the global economy. Systemic risk is something which is kind of new for asset investors. We didn't think about it at all for many years. But suddenly people became concerned about the fact that, for instance, in some financial districts, companies occupying the buildings are actually the same entities renting the buildings, I mean different entities, but the same actually bank, and actually through private equity, maybe owning the building, reinvesting in the buildings. So basically, you end up with this kind of very neat recipe for disaster. Because if anything happens to the main activity of the financial institution, of the investors, basically, they might reduce their use of space, it might have an impact on the value of the properties of the buildings, and because of that, it's a vicious cycle. And people started to think about it in the 1990s. It was done in the UK, the case of the City of London, and I have a paper for you, actually. You have to do your homework afterwards. You have this paper on the City of London. And you will see, actually, it's a big problem in financial centers. When I moved to Singapore, it was one of the concerns of MS, as far as I can know. It was this issue of counter-cyclicality, what could be the link between Singapore property markets and you know what happens in London and other markets. Actually, when you are talking about transnational activities like finance, the link will be immediate, most probably. If the markets are free, of course. The markets are not always free, don't always work completely independently of government intervention. But if the markets are free, the link will be immediate. And finance of all activities is a transnational activity, meaning it doesn't know any border. So can we think of a market that would be sustainable? And guess what? Europeans are dreamers. So actually, the Europeans and the UN, United Nations, decided in December 2008 to organize a high-level roundtable. And the topic was real estate and the financial crisis, causes, effects, and impacts on development. And really what it was about is, let's look at what happened during the financial, the subprime crisis and try to learn from it to modify the way we manage real estate markets to make them more sustainable. Sustainable meaning less prone to boom and burst. Because it's very interesting actually when you listen to American media, the blame will be put a lot more on the financial institutions than actually what happened on the property markets. But actually the financial institutions just use a tool. which is called securitization, which brought a lot of benefit to the economy. But maybe sometimes they did it in a slightly dodgy way. For instance, the case of John Paulson. But in principle, there was nothing wrong with the securitization. The real problem of the global economy was lying in the property markets in the States, because incentives were all wrong. And the French were one of the few to say that. In all the G20 meeting we had in Cannes, in Nice, and all that, there was a lot of demand by Nicolas Sarkozy, we need to control the property markets and so forth. Unfortunately, if you look at what was decided by the G20, it never appears. So it was never actually accepted by the other countries, member of the G20. So basically what we want to avoid is the next recession. We want to make sure that real estate will not trigger the next recession. And one way to do it, which was presented by this UN Economic Commission for Europe, is to set a framework. And the framework is a little boring, but I think it's interesting going through it, because it's not only about existing property markets, but also about emerging property markets. I'm based in Singapore, but I'm very concerned about what's happening in China, the Chinese property market. And they are in the process of really redefining the institution, defining some of the vehicles they want to use to control the property market. So all those recommendations are definitely applicable to China. So they talk about sustainable development, good governance, transparency, accountability, fairness, and efficiency. It's almost like a fairy tale, really, when you look at those words they use. But actually, when you look into the implementation, actually, I mean, there are huge consequences. One consequence which was mentioned by the UN is this issue of green economy. So we are very fortunate we live in Singapore. It's a green city. But it's not always the case that investors or participants in the real estate markets will take into account green economies and the environment. Actually, in China, there are some studies being done, and the more pollution, the higher the price of condos, of apartments, because it means more economic activities. People don't really care so much about quality of the environment at this stage, at least massively. I'm not talking about individual people might care about it, especially if they are very wealthy. But you know, so this issue of building, developing real estate markets that will promote quality of life, the environment, and all that, everything we have come to enjoy in Singapore, but also markets that will be extremely solid and will enable the economy to grow and thrive. And one issue that we see all over the world is this issue of young people. Access to property by younger people, it's an issue in China, a massive issue in China. In Singapore, it's being taken care of by the government, the HDB, and all that, but it's an issue in France as well. So how can we deal with massive flows of immigrants within regions? And again, it applies very well to Asia. And because of all that, the UN said, no, the market cannot be left unregulated. And they proposed 10 principles. So I will go through the principles fast. The first one, when there is a need for a legal framework. Legal framework is really important. I mean, whenever, I remember Lee Kuan Yew making a speech, interesting speech in Shanghai several years back, maybe in 2010, and he said the difference between China and Singapore is basically the legal system, and it makes a big difference for investors. But when you are dealing with physical assets, it makes an even more important difference to have a legal system which is reliable. Recently, we had a presentation from a guy, American guy, he was doing research on the Vietnamese market, and it was very interesting because he said, okay, so in Vietnam, there are laws, but people don't apply the law because there is no enforcement. So what can be the way to make sure that companies will respect the law? And he said the way to do it is simply to involve companies in designing the laws. Because if they are involved, then they will apply them even though there is no enforcement. This is kind of the mindset here in the region. People are trying to find ways for legal systems which are defined but not applied to have a positive contribution on society. So legal framework is really, really important. You need an efficient land register and cadastre. So basically, you need an efficient land registry. Extremely important as well. I mean, there are books which have been written on Latin America, trying to understand why some Latin American countries cannot grow, cannot benefit from the growth of the global economy. And the answer which was given by this economist called Fernando de Soto is that actually it's because they don't have a proper title system. Because there is no title system, people are not willing to commit any kind of money to the development of the economy. So it's really, really important to have a proper land register. And China is actually working on that. Recently, a few months back, there was an announcement trying to create some kind of countrywide system for that. You need efficient services with accessible data and information on market trends. So it's about really making the market more transparent by giving access to data. It seems obvious, but it's very complicated. I mean, it's obvious to have an index of prices. I see people with the Financial Times, business magazines. In those magazines, you will have a lot of indices with the up-to-date price of stocks, of bonds, of foreign currency, gold, whatever. Do you have that for real estate? No, we don't have that for real estate. How can we get that for real estate? How can we get reasonably updated estimation of values in real estate markets? Well, that's a challenge. That's a big challenge. The fourth principle is to recognize that real estate is a driving force for development due to its close interconnection with other sectors. And in France, we have this beautiful saying, French peasants are very smart, usually much smarter than people from the city. And the saying from French peasants is very simply, when real estate is doing fine, everybody is doing fine. Meaning everybody will benefit from it. So, you know, we should all rejoice because real estate markets are doing fine. And it's true to some extent when actually it's doing almost too fine. And then suddenly we don't feel so well anymore. So basically, real estate should be a driving force for development. And again, Singapore is really an example of that. I mean, we see very smart policies being put in place to develop suburban malls, for instance, to gentrify some areas, to promote some areas. And all that takes a lot of knowledge. All that takes a lot of brain power. So it's not possible in every country. And really it's about this issue of turning unused or underused resources into productive capital. And again, in terms of maximizing the space, Singapore is really a beautiful example. I was thinking about the old airport, like they're going to change it and use that land and all that. So it's really about turning every possible asset into something that will benefit society and contribute to the growth of the economy. In economics, we call it productive capital. Last but not, I mean, on this slide, the fifth principle is about governance. Governance is really, really important. So governance is about corruption. Again, we are very sensitive to corruption in this part of the world. It's also about being socially responsible for the need for adequate housing. And it's not obvious. I don't know if there are people who are interested in literature in that room, but if you read like novels from Zola, or even Dickens, all those guys in the 19th century, there will be a lot of mention, actually, people living in the street where actually they are building, renovating parts of the cities, and people don't have access to that. It means actually the property market is not socially responsible. Again, in Singapore, this very ingenious way of having a social housing market, HDB, very efficiently run, and a private market, actually, answer this problem very well. And it works very well. Now, in terms of sustainable financing, it goes back to the awful bankers. Funding has to be sustainable. Meaning, don't give mortgages to people who cannot afford mortgage. Maybe you should think about microfinance to low-income earners instead, instead of selling a dream which is not sustainable. Then it's about transparency and advanced financial products. So transparency is really about this issue of, I guess in the mindset of the UN, it was really about this issue of pool of mortgages. What is the level of transparency of those pools? And it goes back to the responsibility of rating agencies in the crisis. I mean, how much did we know about those instruments, when people who bought slice of those instruments, how much did they understand about it? So this has to be changed. And advanced financial products is kind of a mystery. But coming from a finance background, actually I take it as an endorsement of the research I do. Because usually in finance, in real estate finance, we're not so keen on very advanced financial products. Because complex, not easy to understand. But the UN is definitely trying to promote that. And one of the ideas of the UN in this framework is to promote what they call realistic selling prices. I mean, sellers don't really want realistic selling prices. They prefer higher realistic selling prices because usually they're higher. But really, if you want the market to work well, you need prices which are realistic so that the markets are well functioning. So it goes back to this adjustment of prices, really. So the idea is that if we have access to more financial instruments, more information, then the prices will be more reflective of the real value of the properties. And then the eighth principle, very, very important, is this issue of property valuation. It's easy to value a stock. I mean, the market will value a stock on a daily basis. How do you value a property? So you need values. So there are people actually who are expert in valuing. Maybe there are valuers in that room. ESSEC works with the RICS, Royal Institute of Chartered Surveyors, which is this British organization that has a red book. It's not the Mao red book, it's a valuation red book. Actually, it's a red binder. And it will give you all the rules to value different types of properties. And you have to apply all those rules. Actually, the issue of adopting valuation standards for emerging markets is a big problem for investors. And lots of organizations like AMREF, people I work with on this research actually, are doing a lot of research on that, trying to define methodologies to value properties so that people can agree on valuation methodologies, because it's very important. Otherwise, there would be no argument on prices. Social housing, again, important. Big issue in China. And training and capacity building. So it's about expertise. It's about building, actually, an industry which is large enough to become efficient and to build high-quality services and products. Again, coming from Singapore, maybe you don't see the need of that, because this is exactly what you have. This framework was applied in Singapore. It's like it was designed by the founders of Singapore in some way. To some extent, because I can discuss about transparency and valuation and some of the issues. But when it comes to the space market, social housing, the industry, building an industry, defining financing which is sustainable, and all the principles we saw before, legal framework, land register, efficient services, driving force for development, good governance, yes. All that is something that we are very used to see in Singapore. Unfortunately, it's not always applied in other countries. So, in practice, what can we do? I mean, what can I do to justify my salary, at least my contribution to society, so that I'm not just rambling in front of a room on a Thursday night, but actually doing something useful for society? Everybody wants to be useful at some point. So, what can we do, actually? Well, actually, what we do is innovate. We have to innovate. We have to find new ways to answer to some of those principles, and ways which can be applicable not only to developed economies, but to emerging economies. And this is exactly why, when I moved to Singapore, I applied Principle 5, which was about good governance. So, I designed an index of corporate governance of Singapore REITs. Which was then applied to Malaysia, currently being developed to Hong Kong, Japan, and soon to China when they're going to have REITs. So what is it about, really? It's about promoting transparency of the real estate sector in Asia. It's not to finger point, it's not to say that some are better than others, but just to make sure that actually there is some kind of accountability in the way the system works, because the system is very, very important, actually. Again, this is something which is maybe another truth about real estate. The REIT market is just not about investment. The REIT market is also about providing a system of checks and balances to the space market. So basically, because those assets owned by the REIT are being listed, they serve as a benchmark, as a reference for valuation on the space market in some ways. Actually, in some markets, this is exactly what happened in Japan, for instance. So because you have those dual markets, listed and unlisted, you end up having a much more harmonious commercial real estate market, a much more efficient market. This is part of the mindset of looking at the governance of Asian Real Estate Investment Trust. Another thing that we have been doing at ESSEC is about price indices. This is something that I mentioned before. So I said before, when you have stocks are easy to value. But when you are talking about properties, very complicated to value. How do you value properties? Basically, it's an estimate. Basically, it's either an estimate, so it's going to be an appraisal, which is done by an appraiser. So if we're talking about commercial properties, usually the appraisal will be done every quarter. You have indices of commercial properties. In the States, for instance, you have NCREIF. In Europe, you have a company called IPD. Now it's part of Morgan Stanley, so MSCI, IPD, MSCI. And those guys are producing indices of commercial properties. Those indices are appraisal-based, meaning each quarter, investors, so owners of those properties, so we are talking about institutional investors, will fill out a form in which they will report their estimate of the value of their properties. And usually, once a year, at the end of the year, they will ask a valuer, professional valuer, to give them a professional valuation of the property. They don't do it every quarter because it's too expensive. There are issues with using the system. One issue is that valuers are very nice people, extremely nice people, extremely interesting people. It's a very difficult job, but they tend to look backwards. So they will look at comparables to make estimate of present value of properties. And because of that, you always have in those indices two characteristics. One is lagging, meaning the index will actually lag the real value of the properties if they were valued on a timely basis. And the other is smoothing. So basically, the index will be, if you have an index, if you have a curve, you know, like so if you have a, you know, if you have a REIT, let's say you have, you know, the portfolio of a REIT is being is being valued. So you have, you know, the price of the REIT, okay, that would be that, for instance. So this is with some caveats, this is basically the value that the market is willing to put on underlying properties in the REIT portfolio, plus or minus goodwill for the quality of the management, kind of. I mean, let's say it's like, to simplify it, it's like that. If valuers will look at the properties, usually the curve will look like that. So, something like that. So it's smooth and it's lagging. So can you rely on that to actually estimate the real condition of the property market? The answer is no, you cannot. But actually investors are using that to invest or pension funds, for instance. So they have to make bets on that. And they're gonna look at correlation and all kinds of measures using those indices, which are actually smooth and lagged because of the way they're constructed. They're appraised, okay? So an alternative to that is to look at transactions. So what is a transaction-based index? Very simply, and this is something that Schiller defined, and he made a business out of it, the Case-Shiller index, what we call repeated sales index. So you have the same property being sold over time, several times. Each time you locate the property and you look at the increase or decrease, and it gives you an indication of the situation of the market. So it's very nice. It works very well to a point, because actually the issue is that if there are no transactions, what is the valuation? What is the price if there are no transactions? Is it the old transaction price? So there are no transactions, suddenly the market is completely flat. Does that mean that the price doesn't change? Actually the value should be the same, endlessly, until somebody is willing to buy it at the same price, or higher price, or lower price? Tricky, huh? How do you do that? So basically, some people come up with an idea. And the idea is to look at constant liquidity indices. So a constant liquidity index will take into account what I mentioned before about this point, equilibrium point, where the supply and the demand have to meet, basically, for a transaction to take place. And they will forecast what is this equilibrium price based on liquidity in the market. So basically, if for many months there were no transactions, then there's an issue. So what will happen actually? The model used to design those indices will adjust the price down until there is demand, supply, demand. So there are estimates of liquidity which has been done and embedded into the prices, into the index. If you think about it, it's very smart and it makes a lot of sense, because liquidity is an additional dimension to property markets you don't have in stock markets, for instance. But liquidity is always an issue in stock markets. But in a well-efficient functioning market, you don't have to worry too much about liquidity. In real estate, it's definitely something you always worry about. What is the liquidity of the market? Even if you own your apartment, your home, as a transaction, you know what's happening. Well, actually, if there are no transactions, if the time to sell on the market increases considerably, it means actually the prices should be adjusted down. And this index will take it into account. So ESSEC does research like that. We have done research like that for the Paris market. Actually, we have one professor at ESSEC who can forecast the price of any apartment in any district in Paris. You just tell him where it is. So north part of the 16th district, south part of the 16th district, he will tell you exactly. buy, no buy, because he has designed indices like that with some of his colleagues. And what research has shown is that constant liquidity values will tend to lead transaction-based and appraisal-based indices in time, and also to display greater volatility and cycle amplitude. Why does it matter? Why does it really matter to have an indicator that will lead transaction-based, I mean, transactions or even appraisals, and that will be more volatile and more faithful to the cycle amplitude? Why does it matter? Very much. Remember what I said before? It was many slides ago. One of the issues with property bubbles is that we don't see them coming, basically. We don't see the burst coming. And when we know it's here, it's too late, because we rely on false indicators. We don't have the proper information to judge, actually, whether something is happening or not in the market. If you rely on just appraisal-based index, you will just say, oh, the market is not very volatile. Everything is fine. So I should not worry about it. Actually, when you look at constant liquidity, it will give you a leading indicator that something is really going wrong and that you have to be super, super careful. And it's really important. I mean, property owners, of course, we would care about it, but it's really important for portfolio managers because it will give them a better view of real estate as an asset class. If they compare with other asset classes, actually, the fact that they have a better, more representative view of the risk and return to be expected from real estate will give them a better view. In China, again, because China is important in this part of the world, we don't have indices, actually, of commercial prices. We have indices of residential prices, but we don't have any reliable index of commercial prices. Recently, last year, I did some research using indices put together by Morgan Stanley, so MSCI, IPD. They are very interesting indices, but those indices are appraisal-based, which means they are based on the voluntary contribution of investors. So if you are, let's say, GIC, you own a building somewhere in China, you are willing to contribute to IPD. So every quarter, you will fill out the form and give your estimate of values of your buildings, for instance. They usually work with private equity funds, for instance, and they ask them to fill out. The issue with the index in China is that they're not representative of China. Actually, in the case of IPD, they're only representative of Beijing. So basically, you have a Beijing index, but Beijing is not China. And they sell it as a China index. So if you think about that, really the problem will be, how can we define indices for a country like China? How can we do it? Because it's such a big market, such a big country, so many sub-markets, so many different drivers of those markets. Is it even possible to do it? At this stage, we don't have the answer. So basically, we have to rely on whatever information we have. But constant liquidity would be good, actually, if we can implement it all over the region. It would definitely bring more efficiency to the market. Then another principle we try to apply, actually I try to apply consistently for the last 10 years, is about designing advanced financial products. And why do we need advanced financial products? Actually, you have to put yourself in the mindset of real estate investors or people who work in real estate. How many of you here work in real estate? Only two? Okay. The hardcore people working in real estate, especially people who are more than 40 years old, they don't have any financial, they don't have the financial culture that people would have in other areas. They are deal makers. It's about investing, making deals, making good deals, and basically an accumulation of good deals will end up in good returns. This is what investors are asking for, even if they invest billions of dollars. It's kind of a mindset. Don't get me wrong. They have this uncanny ability to spot opportunities. And most finance people don't have that. But those real estate professionals, they have that. But what does it mean? If you talk to them about options, derivatives, futures, what's that? Why are you talking about stuff I don't know and I don't understand? Why would I need them? And then you have to explain. So you go back to basically a guy which is kind of a legend, actually, in real estate research. His name is James Grassmont. He's the guy who started the Wisconsin School of Real Estate. So it's one of the large schools in America. And he was on a wheelchair But from his wheelchair, he had all those visions about what real estate should be and should become, and he was right. And in 1970s, he wrote this nice sentence. It's a little too long, but I will just focus on the bold characters. And he said, the ability of real estate to glide through economic adversity can be likened to the helicopter, which, in the absence of power and pilot control, has a natural glide angle of a falling brick. So not so good, really. Meaning, what does it mean? It means, actually, if the economy changes, if the environment changes, real estate investors are not well equipped to deal with that change. Because if there's no liquidity, they're stuck with the building, what do they do? So in Singapore, you will see a lot of constantly very active management of shopping malls, for instance. Constantly refurbished, like Capital Mall and all that, Bugis and Raffles City, constantly changing the mix, upgrading the game and making it more professional. Singapore, okay? Not every country, not every company is like Capital Land. So what does it mean? Actually, most investors wait until it's too late. So it's too late, so they're stuck with non-producing asset. So how to deal with non-producing asset? Well, that's an issue. And that's why academics and people like me have been working very hard on trying to find ways to manage risk in real estate. And one such a way to manage risk in real estate is to design financial instruments. And this red paper Schiller is usually recognized as the one who asked for the creation of property derivatives that should be part of mortgage contracts so that home buyers are automatically protected. Meaning, if you get a mortgage, you don't have an option to say, I want protection or not protection, it's automatic. So you are de facto protected against a decrease in the value of your home. That was his idea initially. And actually, such derivatives exist. And Schiller is a smart businessman because he asked one of his PhD students to design those repeated sales index. His name is Weiss. So the index initially was Case, Schiller, Weiss, but Weiss has disappeared now, it's only Case, Schiller. And there are actually derivatives trading in the US, on the Chicago Mercantile Exchange, on 10 American cities. And you can buy property futures and options, not on all the cities, futures on all the cities, but options only on 5 cities. And they give you a protection against fluctuation in prices in properties in those American cities. So we are talking about New York, Boston, Philadelphia, Chicago, San Francisco, Los Angeles, a few large cities like that. For many years, actually, exchanges were really opposed to this idea of having property derivatives. Really, really, really opposed. Why? Well, actually, those guys are extremely conservative. The exchange usually are extremely conservative, and there are good reasons for that. Because the business of exchange is never easy, but launching new derivative instruments is very costly, and the likelihood of success is very small. On average, studies done by the Bank of England show that over 70% of new derivatives will fail within 1 year. So they invest a lot of money in design, in launching the product, and then they lose the money because the market has to close. And it happens for many derivatives, like the economic derivative market failed in the US, although it's a good market on paper. So those guys from the CME, they are very conservative. My own experience with those guys is that they come from the brokerage business. So you're talking about guys who used to be brokers, derivative brokers, who used to work in the pit, and suddenly they become researchers in those institutions. That's my experience. So they don't understand real estate, and they don't believe real estate is an easy asset to design derivatives on. And for many years, it was like that. More importantly, actually, the exchange were really concerned about manipulation of the physical market. That's really a big concern for exchange. Because in the past, there were notorious cases of some commodities being cornered, being manipulated by investors, so that they would corner the cash market so that they would make a profit on the derivative market, on the futures market, options market. And for many, many, many years, actually, derivative markets, standard exchange, were very opposed to having any kind of derivative on physical assets that can be cornered. Think about it. Imagine there are derivatives in a small market, like American cities are not small. But you have the power to control the physical market in some American cities. You own all the properties in San Francisco or the top properties in San Francisco. You might be tempted to play the market using futures and options. So in effect, you will corner the market. And the exchange, because their reputation is on the line, they want to avoid it by all means. And that's why for many, many, many years, there were no ways for investors to hedge risk in real estate by getting into derivatives. I'm talking about homeowners. In Europe, we don't have contracts for homeowners, but we have contracts for commercial properties. We have traded on Eurex, which is Euronext. We have contracts on IPD indices. So we have contracts on appraisal-based index, so basically valuation, which are self-reported by the investors. And those contracts are being used by investors to hedge risk in commercial properties. And the paper, which is here, which was published for last month for the Private Equity Real Estate Association, called AMREF, based in Hong Kong, is exactly about that, looking at how we could use those instruments. But the success of those markets has been very, very limited, because actually, in terms of hedging effectiveness, it doesn't work so well. Do you know why it doesn't work so well? Well, if you own a home, let's say in Philadelphia or in Boston, you have one index to proxy the price of your home. Is it sufficient? There are many types of homes. Small home, big homes, garden, no garden, central, suburban. So basically, there is an issue. And the issue in finance, we call it idiosyncratic risk. And I will show you what I've been doing at ESSEC, actually trying to solve this issue. So suppose you own a home. So this is your home. Okay? It's a nice little home in Boston. No garden, just like a brownstone. You want to buy a derivative to cover your risk. So you go on the market, you buy one of those products using the Cash-Shiller index. And basically, you end up with, you know, this is your return, or expected return. And so you buy this derivative, whatever strategy you put in place. I mean, I don't get into that. But basically, then you have your risk. And your risk is broken down into two components. Your risk is broken down into components which are covered by the derivative and components which are not covered by the derivative. So in usual financial lingo, we would say that the risk which is not covered, let's say this one, actually, is a basis. It means the risk you cannot cover using an index to hedge the price of your home. Okay? Now, it works very well for financial assets. Why? Because in financial assets, actually, the risk structure is a structure which is mostly, the market risk is larger than the idiosyncratic risk for most financial assets, for stocks in general. Actually, for home, it's exactly the opposite. Meaning, when you buy the derivative, when you buy this index to proxy your home, so you buy the Boston index, your home is in Boston, the risk which could be covered by the index might be only that part. And all that is specific to your home, because you have two windows and you have a small door and no trees in front. And because of that, the index which is being used by the CME and designed by Professor Schiller will not cover your risk. So in effect, you're not covered. So your basis is huge. And what I've been arguing for many years, I'm doing it at this second year, is that actually the reason is very simple. Because those markets are created using the financial model in mind, meaning people are using the index-based model. So a derivative using an index, this is the index, and the index will only cover this part. And this part is not covered, okay? So what can we do to cover that part, still using a derivative? And to do that, I have proposed several models, and it's part of the paper. It's research, so it's financial innovation, I guess. So I've said, let's design several models. One model could be a factor-based model using an index and factors. So we have factors, you know, little factors. And those factors will address this part of the risk, because the index actually only covers this part. So it's called a combinative model of derivatives. This is a model I've been testing for here at this sec. Another model can be only factor-based. So we don't use indices at all, and we say the risk is no longer captured by an index because it doesn't work. It works only for financial assets. The risk will be only covered by factors. Okay? So then you end up with something like that, and you choose a combination of factors that will cover as most as possible of your risk to reduce the base as much as possible so that you are fully covered. Well, this is what I mean, financial innovation applied to the issue of efficiency of property markets. So in a way, by doing that, we are trying to answer to the needs which are being expressed by the UN, but also to the needs of investors to make sure the market is more efficient. Then what else do we do? Well, we are a school, so we have an executive program in real estate in France. We have short-term programs and an executive in the real estate sector. And the next one is in July. So you can contact my colleague here, Nathalie, if you want more information on that. We have a chain real estate with BNP Paribas. The chain real estate is mostly focused on market analysis. And we are very good in explaining the workings of the office market in Paris or London, for instance. Well, it's mostly France. But it's really about market analysis. And this campus in Singapore has been used as a platform for pan-Asian and cross-border research, which is anchored on long-established expertise in Europe. So this is my very small contribution to trying to make real estate markets more efficient. Then in terms of what could define a virtuous real estate market, because we need a conclusion, we can't just live with all these questions in mind, actually it's about balance between the space market and the asset market to make sure the market is sustainable. We are talking about harmonious development of the built environment. Again, Singapore is a nice place to witness that. We are talking about markets that will meet citizen needs, providing space for people. Now the big question, the big $1 trillion or even more dollar question, do you believe that actually these property markets are too far in Asia and actually overpriced? And do you believe that there will be a massive bubble burst in China? And I met a lot of enemies recently, last year, arguing actually, no, it's not the case. Because when you think about it, what are those factors which will have an impact on the return of a property? Those factors will be mostly, for commercial properties, it depends, but let's say for office markets, they will be mostly macro factors. One factor that has a huge impact and has been identified for many years on the return of office properties is personal consumption. So it's very strange, actually. Office returns are somehow linked to personal consumptions. And it's true in the US, it's true in Singapore, and I tested it in China, and it's true as well. Actually, it depends on the city. It works very well for Beijing, not so well for Shanghai. So actually, the factors we are talking about are macro factors. What does it imply? As long as there is growth, as long as there is an increasing role for the Asian economies in the global economy, the property markets will keep growing. It doesn't mean there won't be short-term adjustments, because it's really about making sure that market forces and state intervention can coexist. And again, in Singapore, it's a perfect example of a nice coexistence between private and public, and all that trying to end up with an harmonious development of the city. In China, it's more complicated. For many, many years, actually, the Chinese were very reluctant to price property market and properties. They were very reluctant to put cooling measures in place. So I think now they come back to a more balanced approach, because they understand, actually, they can't go too far. If it goes too far, then the adjustment, even short-term, will be potentially dangerous. And I'm more concerned about the consequences of a short-term adjustment that goes too far than really by a massive adjustment that will destroy those Asian economies. Many people think differently. If you go to NUS, there is one NUS academic, very well known, and we argued actually on a panel last year, who believes that actually the Chinese markets are very speculative because they are sentiment driven. So it's really like a musical game chair, you know, who's going to be last standing. I don't believe that. I believe that actually looking at the returns of those markets, I believe that as long as there's growth in Asia, an expectation of growth in Asia, the markets will be sustainable. It's really about having a collaboration between the states in those countries and the private sector to make sure that it doesn't go overboard. So far, the Chinese have shown a very strong willingness to intervene. Whenever they want to make an example, they make an example. Developers will go bankrupt, but they would not have left Lehman go bankrupt. I don't think this is what the Chinese would have done, and I don't think this is what they will do with their real estate markets. Any questions? Sorry, I can't hear you very well. Maybe we need to mic.
Just now you mentioned about property cycle. Later on you talk about risks. Risks is widely believed improve the market transparency and efficiency and liquidity as well. So do you think that the growing of risks actually can potentially solve the issue of property cycle?
It's kind of a complex issue. I was asked last year to write a report on the benefits of REITs for Asian economies. It was like a full spectrum report on social benefits, financial benefits, and I gave up because it's so somebody has to do it because it's very complex. And I think it's difficult to pinpoint really the benefits. Now, there are two dimensions to your question. The first one is about the industry. Yes, the REIT model is very useful to recycle capital. And that's why the Chinese are very keen on actually implementing this model for the developers. Because if there is no way for developers to recycle capital, then the REIT system, if you will, because the system between developers, investors, space users, becomes non-sustainable. I would say it becomes unhealthy. So in that sense, actually, the REIT model is very useful. Now, in terms of transparency, yes, I believe in that. And actually, I wrote it in China last year. I published an article in a magazine for asset investors, and I said, you have to implement the REIT model in China because this will be one way to tame speculation. And I think the Chinese are quite aware of it nowadays. So the next big REIT market will be China, that's for sure. Now, is the REIT market in itself devoid of any kind of shortcomings? No, of course not. As you know, if you follow the news, you know that the REIT market in Asia is defined according to a different model from the REIT model in the States, because it's an external management model. So it's different. So it creates other incentives for developers to intervene. I mean, possibly in the way REITs are managed. That said, what I like about the external model in Asia is that it fits very well with the model of capitalism that you have in those countries, which is, I mean, in theory, we call it a Confucian model of capitalism, meaning with strong reference shareholders, okay? Whether they are the states, whether they are conglomerates. In the case of REITs, we are talking about developers. And they are really in charge of the way the REIT is being managed and all that. And if you run the numbers, like if I use my index of corporate governance and I look at returns and I try to identify whether REITs with a strong shareholder will tend to outperform others, or let's say REITs with a lot of related party transaction, do they outperform others? Because the mindset coming from the West, especially from America, will be related party transaction for REIT means actually value destruction, okay? But if you look at the numbers, it's actually the opposite. Because in markets like Singapore, like Hong Kong, to some extent Japan, REITs are investing in relatively small space market. I mean, kind of very controlled. And having access to properties, thanks to your sponsor, so in that case the developer, is very positive for the returns. So it's very counterintuitive, but this is what we find. And this is one Asian specificity, if you will, which is very different from the way REITs are organized in the States. No, what I find sad about REITs in Singapore, when I listen to journalists or analysts sometimes on TV, they only talk about REITs as an alternative to fixed income. It's all about rate. It's all about the rate increase, so the REITs should decrease, so not so attractive anymore, and so forth. But the REITs are not. I mean, when I worked as an investment manager, I remember getting all those research reports about REITs, and it was always an alternative to fixed income. This is a mindset when you're in the industry, I guess. But if you think about a REIT, it's really a company which is owning and managing buildings. So if you invest in a REIT, that's because you believe the buildings are properly managed. So you don't invest just because you want to find an alternative for returns. You invest because you believe, actually, it's a good management team, and they're going to deliver value over the long run. And that's why you do it. But most of the time, what I hear, what I read, is a lot about REIT as only a financial investment. But it's a real estate investment. It's just a vehicle with real estate inside. Other questions? So for those of you who want some reading, there is no homework unless you come back. You can have a copy of this, which is really about those models of derivatives applied to the city of London. The reason I applied it to the city of London is that I couldn't find the data in Singapore. But my mindset was to apply it to Singapore, but I could not find the data. Because I was trying to see at a property level what kind of edge I could find, what kind of coverage I could find. So it's really interesting, I mean, not that, but the concept is really interesting because it's not only about covering the risk, but those factors can be used to replicate the returns. So we are talking about synthetic replication. So we are talking about synthetic properties. So it opens the door to a lot of possible strategies for investors, which go way beyond the physical ownership of properties. So I leave it here. Thank you very much.